Hi everyone. So I have Bart Jaworski with me today, who's a senior product manager at Microsoft, right?
Right, that's right, though, especially in Skype, which used to be a different company, even inside Microsoft.
Right, yeah, of course. So it was acquired, right? When was it acquired? A couple of years ago already, right?
We just had our 18th birthday last week. And I think it was about like 7, 8, 9 years ago.
Gosh,
I'm not sure really. I recall that day because I was heavy Skype user back then, and we were
I know, me too. And then you had to log through the Microsoft account at some point if you were Windows user.
An MSIX account. Yeah, it's exactly. A very convenient thing because it connects your Office account, your Microsoft Shop account. But there's one funny thing about it, because on the before the transition, you could have had your private login to Skype, which was not removed for the legacy users. So out of the whole Skype team, 1/3 of us has this unique string that we can log in. Everyone else who joined after that needs to have a Microsoft registered email and not a custom string. But unfortunately, it's not available anymore.
Yeah, well, that's actually, something I want to kind of chat with you about a little. By the way, Bart is my compatriot from Poland. So I feel he's my special guest now. He's the only other Polish person on Product Drive, speaking on Product Drive. But you mentioned before we started this conversation, you mentioned that you are actually working on a product that is competing with Zoom, right?
Yeah. It's called Meet now. It's part of Skype, but it's meant to be easiest, fastest, best and fun way to meet. Of course, we are not completely there yet, but when I have the opportunity to talk on Zoom, on Google Meet, I feel it's going on par, and there's a full backlog of the team's ideas that I'm developing now and making sure that I can have a very, very not a very good, because it's already quite good, but the experience that matches the vision. So it's like this unique blend of best of both worlds, where on one hand, you can have your chat list, your contact list, and meet with only the people you need to meet. But on the other hand, you can invite anyone in the world with a single link, and the other person doesn't need an Skype logged in. He or she doesn't need an MSIX account to register. It's just start, join the call, and that's it. You can use it in browser, you can download the client, but it's meant to be a very convenient way to get anyone you need on the call. We were just making fun with Emilia about Zoom, that I am using now Zoom for the first time on my Mac, which I despise with all my heart, being a Windows fan, and not sucking up to Microsoft, by the way. It's just a lifelong dedication. And it was quite funny because I tried to join the meeting and Zoom didn't even tell me I need to download Zoom first. So it was, fortunately for me, horrible user experience.
Yeah, I've had a horrible user experience with Zoom. I feel like we could have a Zoom bashing club, especially at the beginning of the pandemic. Now, the year and a half that I've been using it, I feel like it's improved a lot, right? So I told you, I used to make someone wait 18 minutes for me in the waiting room because it didn't have the sound, basically notification that someone has entered it. And there is still a lot to do. So actually, it's a really interesting topic in terms of product management, right? Because it's an area where I used to think there is Skype, right? There is Google Meet. Why the hell do we need another platform for communication? And then Zoom took the landscape over during the pandemic, right? It kind of became a symbol of remote work at that time. And now you're planning to enter the market with something even new. Do you think there is still space for that? There is still space for more innovation in that?
There's lots of space of innovation. We all feel that meeting remotely. It's not the same experience as meeting face to face.
That's true.
That has not changed with Zoom, with Meet Now, nor with like GoToMeeting or BlueJeans. Like the there were other Zooms before the king arose somehow. But no one got it right yet. And there's lots of different factors that go into that, like the disparity between the audio and visual quality of participants, the fact that you are constantly muted and you don't know about it. It's a totally different experience that is not yet on par by any software with the face-to-face meetings, while giving you the opportunities that are not there when you use the online meetings. So you can aspire to at least make it level to face-to-face meetings and then exceed it thanks to the, how is it called? Augmented reality feature that you can embed. I just like thought that, how about like we put something in the meeting in Skype that if you need someone to do something and you don't have volunteers, you just use a button and the meeting randomly chooses someone for you. And you can say being highlighted who can be chosen, like this video game. How do you call like Jeopardy? That's called... game nights, you know, this kind family feud and this kind of stuff.
Like almost Hunger Games. maybe not like that. But you mentioned something that was quite curious and that kind of resonates with me. You said that, well, the king arose somehow, with the stress on somehow. I was wondering, what was it that made Zoom so popular during the pandemic?
I wish I can tell you that. That, to be quite honest, I did not think too much on the subject, but it might be a combination that they were on the rise in the right moment. The name was popular just when it should. Maybe it was a campaign that helped them to get enough traction at the right time of history, because it wasn't anything, there's nothing very unique about Zoom. I recall using Zoom-like software called GoToMeeting years before Zoom came in. And honestly, apart from a maybe more 90s, early 2000s interface, there's nothing that I can point out that differentiates GoToMeeting from Zoom. And Zoom also is not like doesn't have like this UX that makes you love it. But while hating Macs, I do appreciate the fine detail that comes into designing it, and trying to choose the best options for the user. And that's not, Zoom didn't win clients by the Apple way. It had to be something that is outside the functionality. Or maybe it was just the reliability that honestly wasn't there with Skype then. And Skype was also not like on the pedestal even before the pandemic. Yeah. And maybe BlueJeans and GoToMeetings are less reliable than Zoom, even though the process is still lacking in some areas.
Yeah, then there is Google Meet as well, but it's interesting what you mentioned, that sometimes it's about the timing and just this tiny little detail that differentiates like reliability. I wonder, because you mentioned as a product manager, you have been a Windows person. I have been a Windows person all my life as well. But like a year ago, a bit more than a year ago, I was kind of forced to switch into Mac. And, you know, I was swearing blind all my life, it will never happen. I will never, you know, like be an Apple person, because I kind of felt, you know, in principle, I'm a minimalist. It was just like so overpriced, right? But then I had to use it because my regular Windows laptop broke and I borrowed a Mac. And, you know, it happened. Like what everybody says will happen, you will never go back. And I never went back. But I don't really, you know, I haven't thought about it. Why? From the perspective of, you know, a regular user rather than product manager. So from your product management perspective, what is that you don't like about Apple?
I think that for me, it's being different from Windows in a way that doesn't really justify it. I mean, I had so many problems just yesterday to switch a single application between the two screens because no reason really. I don't know if it was the coding limitation or whatever happened, but I ended up Googling it just to find out that I need to first start an application to enter a mode that allows me to switch a single screen between monitors. And I was like, oh my God, why is it this so frustrating? But I can tell you more about my adventure with iPhone, which I was also forced to use after my Android device broke, which I also said I will never use because I hate it. And the experience was excruciating until you get used to the limits. And then I could come back to Android and I went back and I suffered almost the reverse because I found that things that were convenient on Apple suddenly became less convenient on Android. Like payments suddenly require me to enter PIN, whereas the Apple was fine with my fingerprint. Since then, Android had that as well. But it's all about really getting to use the brand, having the quality that is on the level that doesn't frustrate you enough to toss it away, getting used to it. And then when you suddenly do encounter something similar that is quite different at the same time, then the frustration comes. And it's especially prominent if you do it in a professional environment where you need to do things efficiently, where the tools are there to help you and not to just be there. I mean, if I'm doing something privately, I probably have more time to take a deep breath, figure out things. But if I'm on a deadline, I'm about to start a meeting and I can't set my machine the way I need it to, that rises your blood pressure and gives you the additional layer of complexity and difficulty in a professional setting that you don't need because it's already challenging enough and you just want tools to help you and not be another set of challenges. So for me, what Apple does great is to be able to create the designs that appear to broaden broader audience by making it simpler, but the simplicity for another user will be a limitation. Like me and my fiance can't figure out why the hell can't you change the alarm clock sound on your iPhone. This is like the stupidest limitation I can think of.
This is like Nokia 3310 feature level, right?
Yeah.
It's good that
they allow you to change the ringing sound, I think.
A ringtone, yeah.
Yeah.
That would have been hilarious if you couldn't.
I have a similar story where my mom used to work at the Kia dealership and one of the cars they sold lost its guarantee when the owner removed all the Kia logos and this type kind of stuff and replaced it with Mini just for shits and giggles. And then they said, we're sorry, you have disconnected yourself from the brand. There is a guarantee point that tells you that you need to show that you're Kia, otherwise you lose the guarantee. And I think maybe Apple would like to have the same. You need to sound Apple and look Apple, otherwise you are no longer considered an Apple user.
Yeah, that's really funny. Like the brand identity, I saw a really funny meme on that, you know, a couple of weeks ago. It was like the first sound meme that I've ever seen. It was basically like the sound of Apple starting is like the few first notes of Nothing Compares by Sinead O'Connor. And, you know, once you hear that, you can't unhear it.
Oh my God, I did change my Samsung ringtone to a Nokia ringtone recently just for the fun of it, and now I'm not recognizing that my phone is ringing.
Oh God,
who has this old style phone ring? Oh, it's me. And it's been going on for weeks. It's ridiculous
because everybody probably associates the old ringtone with a Nokia. Like, you're a product manager at Microsoft and you have a Nokia 3310 and they're like, what? But it also kind of points us to the bigger question of it all, like that product management is largely about understanding the user psychology. So largely about understanding the human psychology, which is kind of nicely pushes us towards the main topic that I wanted to discuss, basically the topic of your presentation at Product Drive, which is like how to break into, you know, the product management field. And Bart, yourself, you created a course on that, like how to become a product manager. I haven't finished it. You probably know that. I started the course. You know, it's been busy, la di da. But anyway,
11 hours. It's not an easy task for an adult to find that amount of time. I can't blame you.
But it's all because of the technology. It keeps me hooked. It keeps me like doing things that I shouldn't be doing, so I can't do your course. But in all like seriousness, do you think that, for instance, like what is the field that is, you know, the best, the closest to product management to transition from? Because there are no like degree courses in product management at the moment. People I talk to who are product managers come from absolutely all fields. Like the last 2 weeks, I talked to people who used to be engineers, who used to be HR people, who used to be marketers, who used to be customer success people. So, you know, like, or should they maybe be psychologists, right? what do you think?
Yeah, it's so weird because this is like this kind of a position that's both opportunistic and like unreachable because of the fact that the path to it is so unknown. Mm-hmm. It just happens that there's an opening in a company, you manage to get promoted to it, and then you finally have that experience that can help you move on to bigger and better companies that are looking for those experienced mm-hmm. product managers. And I get to talk to people every day asking me how to start my product manager career. I literally have series of videos on my YouTube channel that's called Breaking into Product Management, mm-hmm. where I have 10 plus videos that tell you how to break from X to product manager, and they all have to be started with another video on how to get promoted to product manager, because mm-hmm. it's all about looking for the opportunity to get this career and finding the environment that allows you to do that. Because as you said, everyone can become a product manager. This is, I would say, one of those ultimate positions that encompasses lots of different positions. I think that there is a common graph that shows like three circles correlating in a single point that it says technology, UX, and something third. I would personally add like additional six or seven circles to that, because
I've seen one like that as well.
Yeah.
Right in the middle of all these circles.
Of obviously various degree of prominency, and different product managers will excel at different aspects of it. But coming to your question, personally, I think that the thing that you can call closest to a junior product manager is someone that is a business or data analyst. Those people are working very closely to product managers because they are looking for the answers that product manager needs to needs to put the questions for.
Mm-hmm.
So basically they can very, very quickly jump to the mindset of product manager by working directly with him or her. They need to attend all the meetings, all the grooming sessions, all the thing that needs to happen with the team that ends up with a completed backlog item. And the fact that they are data driven heavily and mm-hmm. understand the data, understand how to read it and how to interpret it, makes it that the most important skill is the most highlighted in their portfolio, and at the same time they are close enough to the process and the team to catch everything that's needed to start off with the product management. But this is just a single career that's maybe like 10-15% more prominent to do it and might appear organic in some companies. But it's the same exposure for developers, it's the same exposure for UX engineers. You did say customer success or client support, which are very close to the clients on the other hand and have a lot of conversation and understanding of the market and the product and what client needs to put it all together into a fabulous backlog that's maybe not like macro data driven, but data driven enough to speak of enough numbers to rationally justify the choices.
Mm-hmm. And
close to the clients makes them prominent to understand how to grow the product to make it more appealing to the user. They are not disjointed. And I could say that another career that is very likely to become product manager are business startup owners who come to me asking the same question, being completely confused on how to begin, whereas it's just a realization that they are product managers already, just with much more to do being an owner. And if you drill it down to the essence of a product manager's task to adapt a product to the market needs and listen to the feedback in order to grow the product in the right directions, what any CEO or an owner needs to do, apart from thousands other things. So it's all up to this person to put the right story in the CV, use the right words so the recruiter and the algorithm can pick up on the talent, and then tell the compelling story on the job interview of the owner who decided that it's better for him or her to focus on a certain aspect, which is very complex to begin with, of being an owner, which is product management, and not worry about accounting, marketing, hiring, and all that comes with being an owner, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That kind of reminds me, you know, of my story. A couple of years ago, I was in China and I was building an app for experts there as, you know, a co-founder. And we made the classic mistake that I still feel, you know, a lot of product managers make, even in big companies, and I will touch upon that in a second. We built something that the end user ultimately didn't want. But we thought they should have it. We were like, yay. I had a conversation with Nir Ayal last week, and he used this metaphor of chocolate-covered broccoli, right? The broccoli is what you build, and chocolate is what the user wants. So you put some chocolate on broccoli, and you're like, there, now you eat it, right? But they didn't want to eat it. And I was about to post about it on LinkedIn before we jumped on the call. I just saw that LinkedIn is actually killing one of its fairly recent features.
I saw that.
LinkedIn stories.
And
it made me think, you know, like even LinkedIn product manager is such a big company with so many resources, is making these mistakes. And I was like, why did they just copy and paste a feature without like really thinking of the whole ecosystem and how the user of their product thinks differently compared to the user of Facebook or Instagram? What do you think about that? Can you make a comment on this decision by LinkedIn?
Well, if you look at Skype's history, we used to have stories as well.
Oh, wow, really?
Awesome. We don't anymore for the very same reasons.
All right.
Stories do not universally translate to a better product overall. They need this specific Instagram process where they make sense.
Mm-hmm.
They also make sense on Facebook, but it's a mistake that has a history that likes to repeat itself, like with what happened with Clubhouse, mm-hmm. which was like you have those music performing artists that have one song only, and Clubhouse for me is this product that had its spotlight and now it's basically gone.
What happened?
They renamed, they are called something different now, but I don't know.
I remember
the name of the new name of the club.
Really? Wow, that's crazy.
But a lot of companies jumped onto the hype and now we're building our Clubhouse, which was a road to nowhere. That's actually hilarious to look at. And the story of stories on Skype, mm-hmm. is like the prominent highlight on where did Skype went wrong in its history. And it's up to my department and my team, other teams in Skype, to now go back to the basics and rediscover what Skype became in the market. There is now, let's say, a gap where Microsoft needs to step in and show the world that we are not only a provider of corporate solutions, but we also need to be significant in the consumer market. And it's Skype, Teams for Life, GroupMe that is there to fill in the gap. And we are there to find our way again. Skype is not Slack. It's not Teams. It's something for the family, for a small community, and for casual spring of the moment meeting. And that's the identity that we need to pursue, and we are pursuing. I have this touching story of my best friend whose wife is Chinese. So the grandparents of his lovely daughters that I adore and love like my own, used to communicate with their grandparents using Skype, being 2 years old.
Wow.
Because they could grab the iPad, touch the picture of grandparent, and there she or he was. They could see, speak with them, they could show them the toy, and the kid didn't mind it. They are in the room. They could literally magically summon the person they cared for and share a magical moment they were having as children. And that is like something that I feel, I recall, whenever there's a nasty bug that prevents us to update, or a developer is unhappy with a piece of the code. And I need to remember that maybe there is a lot of work, but it makes huge sense. And there is place for Skype, despite what some people try to tell me when asking why the hell Microsoft still invests in Skype. Because there are at least 60 million people who rely on us, and I believe there will be far more people than that to account for and to build better future together with.
Yeah, totally. I'm still a Skype user, honestly. You hooked me on the Skype number, because as I said, when I moved to China, you know, like I still had a company in the UK, and that was the way to basically keep my number without locking into some, you know, ridiculous contracts that I wouldn't even be able to use from China, but just like pay as you go. This was super convenient for me. But kind of going back to the big question, like how to prevent situations like what just happened at LinkedIn, right? That you, why did they even make this decision? Because I felt like there was this point where everybody was slapping stories on top of their product. I even recently saw on Product Hunt a product for slapping stories into your product. Like stories as a service, literally. Whatever you are, you just install a snippet of JavaScript and you can have stories in your product. I'm like, a friend of mine was like, you need to check it out. This is future. I'm like, no, this is insane. This is rubbish. This goes against all the principles of product management, where you actually think about the context. And no, it's like, well, feature out of a can, whoever you are. No, it doesn't work like that, does it?
Yeah, it's like thinking that people need quicker horses for transportation in 2020s.
Exactly.
So how to prevent it? I think that the whole shebang with why stories became so prominent was the false sense of certainty that since this feature is so successful for one product, then it can be easily copy-pasted to another and drive the same number of traffic. And those were false hopes. When I talk about choosing ideas to your backlog, I always say that there is a level of effort that is needed to convert an idea to programming that creates a border. if you have something very, very small that you can try, then maybe you shouldn't invest in research, in market analysis. If it's just a change of a button or adding some small detail that can be quickly A-B tested and very dirty hypothesis can be proven with little risk and a big potential reward. If it doesn't pan out, whatever, we lost a few hours of single developer's work. That is an equivalent of going with a weak hand in poker while being on big blind and no one raising the stakes. Mm. Let's see the flop. Let's see what happens. But if you need to invest weeks and months of work to do something, then it doesn't matter that it really worked for someone else. Does it work well with your product? Does it make sense? Do user want it? There are techniques and ways to find that out, to do interviews, to put on a very dirty minimum viable product and A-B test it. Maybe just leak and a false information that you're working on it and see how the press reacts. Mm. This is like something that specifically movie studios do if they want to pitch a movie and there is a leak there.
All right.
The Star Trek, the modern Star Trek movies had at least 4 or 5 different sequels unofficially
announced.
Announced, including a Quentin Tarantino one, and none of them were made because they didn't made enough traction in the media. Mm-hmm. They didn't get the investors' confidence, and thus the studio probably saved millions of dollars in a failed project. And this is again gambling with your time, money, and the possible returns. You can go all in with King 5 just because you saw Mr. Negrano win a huge pot like this in PokerStars. But does it mean that he will win that huge win? Is the probability of the win the same? Of course. It is, but but the destiny will can. Sorry, I got too excited with this poker analogy. I mean, I just want to say that you have to very carefully choose your bets because that's all you do. You are a risk manager when you are a product manager. You need to figure out how to invest the always limited resources you have. And it doesn't matter what product, what team, you will always have more ideas and possibilities than you have resources and people happy to help you with that. You have to make the right choices to get the maximum gain in the minimum amount of time.
But this is super difficult, isn't it? Because like I always feel when I'm, you know, in the process of like coming up with certain ideas and like making bets, especially when it comes to innovation, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, the product I was building in China, let's say it wasn't that innovative, but say now my partner is building something that is pretty innovative in another field, like a CRM for building backlinks. And he's making a huge bet with his time, with his money, with his resources. But on the other hand, like what is the MVP actually? What is the definition of an MVP? When is an MVP enough to present an idea, right? In a way that people understand the value of the innovation, right? It's like super difficult to decide when is this moment when this is ready to go.
You can't imagine how many conversations I had with various teams in my past where a definition of MVP was so hard to find out internally on a feature, because what myself or the management team saw as sufficient to test the hypothesis would be seen by other team members as lacklusting, insufficient, not enough, and they might have been right, or we might have been right. I don't want to put any specific examples. But it's a really hard balance to find. because you may crash a very good idea just by providing not enough value initially.
Exactly.
Or you may, there's this quote I love, that if you are proud of your product on the release date, that means that you have released too late. Right.
Yeah, exactly. But I wonder, because there are, on the other hand, these stories when, you know, like a product flopped, right? Because, but not because it wasn't needed, not because the market need wasn't there, but because it was just, you know, lackluster, as you said, and maybe released actually too early, right? And then somebody else came and built something that was actually providing a little bit, sometimes marginally more value, but there was this enough margin, right, to be successful. And it's so crazy, like I wouldn't have the guts to be a product manager, because I feel you guys, you play poker obviously, so that's why you're a good product manager, because you have that level of risk tolerance, right, to be able to basically put up with this. Yeah, to me, it feels like insanely challenging, right? All these different decisions, like when is too early, when is too late, when is enough value, when is not enough value, right?
Like, and the process is funny in itself. Let's go back to Apple again. Mm-hmm. For me, it's very eye-opening when you look at the history of the first iPhone. First iPhone had barely any innovation. It was hardware and software technology that was there for years, even touch screens, the hand gestures, and all of that. They were available in many different products before, but they were clunky, they were prototype-ish, they were the first to market, and they weren't ready. Only the product management sense of Steve Jobs, who managed to lead a product, because it wasn't his idea by any chance. He had to be convinced on multiple occasions to invest into iPhone. But only the right pitch to the right man, who then pursued the right quality relentlessly, gave us modern smartphones. I don't know if you heard about it, but 6 months before initial shipping, Steve Jobs took a first prototype of iPhone with plastic screen just for the weekend to play around with it. He came back to the office with a very scratched screen and saying that we're not going to ship it like this. We need something more solid. And the engineers were like, we have 6 months. What are we going to do? And they
buy another company.
Yeah, the Gorilla Glass managed to provide them a prototype. Oh, wow. Of very scratch resistant glass, and it all came together. And I can see that in many of my products and initiatives which come together very late because someone has a good idea at the very last second, and it's so good that it can't be ignored. And sometimes no idea like that comes along, and something that could have been better is released, and we don't even know that we missed a great opportunity to improve.
Like, you're pitching it as an extremely exciting career, to be honest. Like,
oh my God. I think it's just me, because I was talking to my fiancée the other day about a small change in Skype I'm introducing that is being inspired on how Dropbox allows you to share files from the file browsing level. And I'm telling her that for me it's a small change, but it's like something, a process that people are used to, that that I'm instinctively looking for. And for me it's this little pitch of quality I'm adding that doesn't probably change a lot, but it was like 3 hours, and we may have a few hundred people positively surprised, not even surprised, just finding the thing that they want to find. And I'm very excited about it. I'm happy it was very quick to do, and it brings quality. And she's like, dude, that's so boring.
Does she also come from like product management background or a different background?
No, she's an analyst in a big four company.
Okay, all right. Wow, that's interesting. Like, how users perceive things differently from people who are inside the trade. I mean, I'm endlessly fascinated by it. Even, you know, my mom's like 60 almost, and she comes from a completely different background. So she's a doctor, basically. And there was this time where there were a lot of articles on The Economist, et cetera, about how, you know, the generations are divided, and there are the digital nomads who grew up in like a certain era. And then there are the people who have trouble adopting technology. Right. And I believed in it for a long time until my mom started using, you know, internet, Alibaba to like buy medical equipment from China, like at quarter of the price that she can buy it in Europe. And, you know, I never saw her as a technical person at all. And suddenly she absolutely took over internet. And what's so funny and what's so eye-opening to me is that she just understands things without any like problem, and that her behavior online, for instance on social media, are so similar to like how I would react, how I would perceive certain behaviors, you know, that it's quite eye-opening that these products are just kind of universally aligned with human psychology. And if something works, it works because it's, you know, it resonates with us on like the psychological level. And if something doesn't work, even if it sounds like a good idea on paper, say LinkedIn stories, it's just wrong context, wrong, you know. So I find it endlessly fascinating.
Amelia, I'm finding this talk so interesting that I think that my talk on product drive will have problems reaching those heights of this conversation.
I was about to say I could talk to you for hours, but you're going to get a sunburn. So we should probably wrap it up. But this is insanely interesting. I'm so looking forward to your full talk. All of you guys who are listening, watching, like tune in to Bart's talk on Product Drive 4th and 5th of October. And Bart also has a course, How to Break into Product Management. We will share the link under this video to the course as well. So thank you so much, Bart, for your time. And yeah, looking forward to seeing you in October.
Thank you. It was delightful. And yeah, looking forward to having the talk.
Absolutely. Have a great rest of the day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.